be said that you want Lower Manhattan evacuated, you want everybody else to go about their business. Are there specific instructions that you want to communicate right now to police, fire, everybody else?
Well, police and fire are there, and they're there in large numbers, and they are, first of all, trying to get into the rubble and the debris to save as many people as possible. We also have thousands of police officers in Lower Manhattan, and what we want people to do is to leave Lower Manhattan, if they can, on their own. Just walk. I just talked to Dick Grasso, who runs the stock exchange, and we have a lot of police there. They have 3,000 people there. We're going to walk them out. We're walking them east and then north, which is essentially the way I walked out. I was right below the World Trade Center when it collapsed, and then we walked up to Greenwich Village. People should walk out of Lower Manhattan, get above Canal Street, for safety reasons, but for a second reason. We need people out of there so we can get thousands of ambulances in and out over the course of the next couple hours. And the fewer people we have there, the more lives we're going to be able to save.
Mr. Mayor, are the subways operating?
The subways are operating outside of Manhattan.
Outside of
Manhattan, the subways are operating. A couple of delays here and there, but in all other four boroughs, the subways are operating. In Manhattan, there are significant delays. We thought we had the Lexington Avenue open, but it is not. I'm just checking right now. The Lexington Avenue is not open. The A train is working, and people will just have to test and see. The best thing to do right now is to walk. The safest and best thing to do is to walk to your destination. Where schools have remained open, and we've worked with the chancellor to try to make certain that the schools will remain open for as long as they have to help parents with the kids that would be coming home, starting at around 1 or 2 o'clock.
Mr. Mayor, as you know better than anyone, and certainly New Yorkers know, but people around the country perhaps do not, this is election day here. What is the status of the election?
We canceled it. The governor and I decided about an hour and a half ago that it made no sense to have an election today. We needed all those police officers who were at the election site, and we need to focus on rescue. So we'll find another day. We'll find another day for the election. The governor and I made that decision about an hour and a half ago.
Mr. Mayor, you're a very focused guy in moments like this. Is it hard, given the magnitude of what's happened here and around the country, to focus on what you have to do and not just be angry?
It's very hard, and it's very, very hard because I know some of the people that are there. They're personal friends and close friends who are in the building, and I haven't been able to find out if they're safe yet.
Your emergency command center, what some people have called a bunker, was located, was it not, in one of the World Trade Center buildings?
It was located close enough to it so that it was affected by it. It's not in one of the buildings, but it was located right in that area, as is City Hall, the police department, and all of them had to be evacuated. So that area of Manhattan, once the I was in a building at the time that we were using as a command center, and we were trapped in the building for a while, for about 20 minutes, not able to get out different exits that were overcome with smoke and debris.
Mr. Mayor, just as a practical question, do hospitals need help? Do they need
Hospitals need all of the help they can get. We're getting a great deal of help from the surrounding areas. The governor has mobilized the state in order to make hospitals available to us outside of Manhattan. Any hospital personnel or emergency personnel that want to come in and volunteer, that would be enormously helpful. But the best thing for us to do right now, we're trying to coordinate, is to move people out of the city to hospitals in surrounding areas, which we're actually doing now. But so far, though, our hospital system is... We're very fortunate to have a gigantic hospital system.
Do they have enough blood? Do they need blood? Do they need people to come in and help them out?
I'm sure they will. We're getting the National Guard to relieve our people by early to late this afternoon. They're being mobilized now. And three urban search and rescue teams are going to come to New York City to help us. And then anyone that wants to volunteer from surrounding areas, volunteer fire departments and others, we're working with them now to do that, to try to relieve our fire department.
It's a horrific day, Mr. Mayor.
There's no possible way to begin to describe it.
No, there is not.
To see what happened there is, of course, it makes you very, very angry. It's almost impossible to describe the level of anger that you have that somebody or someone would do something like this. And
sir,
all of the good and wonderful people that were affected by this, there's no reason for this, there's no excuse for this. And there's something like this, it's just something you never thought you would live to see.
I couldn't agree more, sir. Thank you for joining
Thank
us.
You.
New York's Mayor Rudy Giuliani on what was to be an election day. The mayor not up for re-election because of term limits, but the election has been postponed. Jeff, I just step back for a second.
Well, that's
you
what
know, you talk about anger. Sorry. And we stand up here and we look at this and we've all listened to what's been going on now as we've been on the air for 3 hours or so. And there was a woman that Richard Roth interviewed about a half hour ago who said what I suspect that most Americans are feeling right now, and some would like to say and can't, how angry she was, how cowardly this all seemed to her. Quickly, we go back to Washington and Judy Woodruff. Judy?
Aaron, government sources telling CNN that President Bush, who had been in Florida for a two-day trip and who broke that trip off this morning to head back to Washington, will now not return to Washington. Repeating, President Bush will not return to Washington. We do not know where the president will land or whether where his aircraft will go, Air Force One, but we just are passing along this information just as soon as we have it. Again, as we were talking to former NATO head Wesley Clark, General Wesley Clark, a little while ago, he pointed out that there are contingency plans that the military and the security people have for the president in a situation like this. So we're not going to do any speculating right here about where the president might be going. Joining us now on the telephone, there is some information we want to share with you about aircraft in the sky that is, we're told, is safe right now. We're told by the FAA, the Federal Aviation Administration, they're telling us 50 aircraft are safely in the sky right now, all within about 50 miles of their destination. But in the meantime, we want to talk to Utah Republican Senator Orrin Hatch, who's joining us on the telephones. Senator Hatch, are you there?
Yes, I am.
And I know my colleague Wolf Blitzer, who's here with me in the studio in Washington, had also talked with you. Senator, you've been briefed by what authorities?
Well, I'm on both the Judiciary Committee and also the Intelligence Committee, and I've been briefed by the highest levels of the FBI and of the intelligence community. And I just have to say our thoughts and prayers go out to the victims of this terrible tragedy caused by a bunch of cowards. And there's no justification for what these cowards have done to purely innocent Americans, but I do have some information.
Senator Hatch, this is Wolf Blitzer. Tell us, I spoke with you earlier on the telephone, but tell us precisely what you are now being told in these high-level briefings about those who may, and repeat the word, may have been responsible for these attacks.
You're right. They've come to the conclusion that this looks like the signature of Osama bin Laden and that he may be the one behind this. I think most authorities agree that this is something that we doubt seriously if Iran, Iraq, or Libya would try and do, because they know of the massive response that we'd have to bring down on them. But there was no advance notice at all. They had no way of knowing that this was going to happen. It was carefully planned. And what it means is it seems to me that if that turns out to be true, we're going to have to revitalize Shah Massoud and the other people in Afghanistan who basically are fighting to get rid of this type of terrorism. And I think we're going to have to ask our friends in Pakistan to get in turn to be more cooperative than they have in the past. And then we'd have to work with our allies to have an international strategy to combat this type of international jihad against the West.
We're listening to Senator Orrin Hatch of Utah. We also have joining us on the telephone Senator John McCain from his home in Arizona. Senator McCain, I assume you've been talking to authorities as well.
Yes, Judy, and I am. I'm on Capitol Hill in Washington.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, no problem.
Thanks
yes,
for clarifying.
And, yes. The situation is so serious that words don't describe it. I think that it's clear that the organization and magnitude of the attacks required more than a few people to perpetrate it, and it'll take some time to determine who they are and who supported these attacks. But I think we'll find them out. And they will suffer the full measure of our justice. This is uh, This is obviously an act of war that's been committed on the United States of America.
What do you mean, obviously, an act of war, Senator McCain?
These attacks clearly constitute an act of war, the unwarranted, unprovoked attacks against innocent American citizens is clearly an act of war, and one that requires that kind of national response and international response.
Senator Orrin Hatch, I believe, is also still with us, mm-hmm. Senator. And Senator Hatch, you mentioned the Bin Laden organization. Former NATO head General Wesley Clark also said to us about an hour ago in an interview that he believes that it's only the Bin Laden organization that is capable of carrying out attacks this coordinated and on this massive a scale. What are you basing your information on?
Well, keep in mind, there are nations that also could carry out these attacks, but they, I don't think, would dare do that, knowing that their signature is going to be figured out. We're going to find out who did this, and we're going after the bastards. It's that simple. And I just have to say that both the FBI and our intelligence community believe that this is a Bin Laden signature. And I believe it is. I was the first to point out Bin Laden to the Clinton administration and said they're going to kill Americans, and we've got to get on top of that. And I think we're going to have to get on top of it, because this is a cowardly bunch who will stop at nothing to, like you say, have a jihad or a war against the United States, and to do it in the most cowardly fashion.
But Senator McCain, I mean, there will be those who are saying the United States was taking all reasonable precautions. We had security at airports, metal detectors, mm-hmm. and so forth and so on. How much more is going to have to be done to prevent something like these things from happening again?
Judy, I don't think our lifestyles will be the same for a long time since it was before these attacks, as far as use of transportation, particularly airports, are concerned. There have been warnings about whether our security was good enough and whether the proper measures were being taken. I'm sure that'll all be reviewed. By the way, I have no information as to who caused this, and I hesitate to speculate, but I am confident that the President of the United States will lead us, and we will find out who has carried out these acts. And I think it's a little premature to make that determination until we have the hard facts, but I'm sure that we'll get them. The other aspect of this is that it may highlight over time the need for more human intelligence. We have very good technical intelligence capabilities, satellites, etc., but for many years we haven't had the kind of human intelligence which determines motivations before actions are taken.
I'm going to interrupt you, Senator McCain. These are the first pictures we have in. This is from Somerset County, Pennsylvania. This is where the United Airlines flight, I believe it is 176, went down. I'm sorry, I'm correcting. United Airlines 93. This was a Boeing 757 bound from Newark, New Jersey to San Francisco. It crashed in Somerset County, Pennsylvania, near the town of Shanksville, south of Pittsburgh. We're told about 80 miles outside of Pittsburgh in western Pennsylvania. It is not known how many passengers or crew were on board, although initial reports indicated no survivors. Again, these are the first pictures we have coming in from WTAJ there in the Pittsburgh area. United Airlines telling us earlier they had lost this flight, and they knew that it had crashed near Pittsburgh. There is a second United Airlines flight, the Boeing 767, flight 175, bound from Boston to Los Angeles, has crashed. The airline still telling us at this point that they do not know where. We don't have information on the number of people aboard. It is possible, but not confirmed, that this would have been the second plane to hit the World Trade Center. Now, again, two United Airlines flights, and in addition to American Airlines flights, the flight 11 from Boston to Los Angeles, this was a Boeing 767 with 81 passengers on board, 9 crew members, 2 pilots. This is believed to be one of the planes that crashed into the World Trade Center. All 4 of these planes that we're describing to you now, these flights all headed to California. The second American Airlines flight